Welcome everyone to the August 18th meeting of the Northampton Transportation and Parking Commission. My name is Ryan O'Donnell, I'm the chair of the commission. I'm also the counselor for Ward 3. Let me note the audio and video recording of this meeting, which I will call to order because I note the presence of a quorum. And as we always do for the benefit of the audience, let's go around the table and introduce ourselves, starting with our vice chair.
I'm Counselor Lisa Klein from Ward 7.
I'm Richard Cooper, citizen.
Nancy Forrestall, Assistant City Collector and Parking Enforcement Administrator.
Christy Grant, citizen.
Dave Pomerantz, Director of Central Services.
Ned Huntley, Director of Public Works.
Jody Kessler, Chief of Police.
Thank you very much. We'll begin, as we always do, the period of public comment. I'll say at the outset, I think there are many residents here for a specific item which is on the agenda elsewhere. Public comment, though, is a chance for anyone to comment on any issue for about 3 minutes, just out of respect for everyone's time. You're certainly welcome to comment twice if you want, but again, if you're on the agenda, maybe, just guessing, for Elm Street and Onotuck Street. It's a wild guess. You're certainly welcome to wait for that agenda item to come up too, and we'll move it up out of respect for you, since I know there's lots of people here today. But on any other matters, anyone who would like to speak on any subject, just come right up and state your name and address. Go right ahead.
I'm back. My name is Michelle Squires, 38 Lincoln Avenue, and I was here last month, but and anybody on the agenda, because I'm working on that traffic calming, but a lot of people were away, so once again, we did it years ago, but this month I just want to keep you up to date, because we've tried our own means of traffic calming. We've had, I don't know if you read the police report, but I've had these signs that myself and one of my neighbors purchased for that say, go slow, show the kids. All 7 of them got stolen a week ago. Somebody took every one of them. Yeah, and we have no clue. So anyway, I guess one of the things we're going to ask for is maybe if we can get just, I mean, there's one children sign at the top of the street behind Ducky Tire, kind of in the bushes. If maybe along, when we get to the, I know the signs aren't part of traffic calming, but I think, but maybe permanent city signs that say go slow children or something, or we'll just buy more. But these were nice little cheap ones that kind of work that I got to face on the clearance, so I didn't have, they didn't cost a lot. But anyway, that's all, and we're still working on it. And I know the traffic, the trucks are on the agenda tonight, so we're good with that.
Thank you very much.
Yep.
Is there anyone else who'd like to provide public comment at this time? Well, we'll launch right into the agenda. The first is item number 3, approval of minutes. We actually have a backlog of minutes to approve, and you know, part of it is my fault, since I took on the responsibility of suggesting amendments and corrections to the ones that we haven't approved yet. Suffice it to say, I think we need a little more time with the minutes yet again, and I may approach individual members offline to kind of help with some of the corrections that might be made. But unless there's any objection, I ask to continue the approval of minutes again to the next meeting. So without objection, we will do that. Item number 4, our subcommittee updates. We have one subcommittee, the Bicycle and Pedestrian Subcommittee. And is there anyone who is here today that can speak on behalf of that subcommittee? Maybe not. All right. Well, by default, we will not do that. But we look forward to the report the next meeting. Item number 5 are updates from the DPW. Mr. Huntley, do you want to start us off?
Obviously, we're in full bloom of paving operations in the city. If you want to see what roads are being done, just go to our website and click on the maps or click on the text document and read it. The other big project we have, are actually in a pre-construction meeting tomorrow with the electrical contractor for the Bridge Road school zone lights and the rectangular rapid flashing beacons. There's a couple other projects associated with that, which is the audible pedestrian actuators on New South, South and Old South, and South and Conn Streets. and a dedicated, not dedicated, excuse me, a left green arrow from Main to Pleasant Street. That would queue in advance like it does for King Street on Main on the King for about 3 or 4 seconds. That way we'll get those cars out of the loop there, lit up. And then some regular street maintenance work for some loops and traffic lights. So that's what we have going on right at the moment.
Would you also like to announce a traffic engineer?
Yes, this is Maggie Chan. Maggie came from us from Northampton. She's a resident, been here a long time, and very happy to have her here and in all our transportation in the city.
Okay. We're absolutely happy to have you. Thank you. Are there any questions for the DPW? Okay. Then we will move swiftly along. I'd like to take item number 7 out of order, which is the traffic calming request for Nonotuck Street and Elm Street. This was submitted by, excuse me if I mangle your name, Alexander Papuchis.
Papuchis, that's it.
Very good. I didn't mangle that as badly as I thought of. And I would ask Mr. Papuchis to come up and maybe start us off by
a simple
explanation.
Well, thank you all for giving us the opportunity to come and to present our petition more formally. It's my first time in the year, so I really appreciate the opportunity. I've been a resident of Northampton for 8 or 9 years, and I've been living on Nonotuck with my wife and my daughter for the past 2.5 years. And since we moved, I'm not able to speak to the history of challenges with speeding and traffic issues on Nonotuck. I'm sure some of the other residents who have joined us here will do that. But I would just say in short that Nonotuck Street is, as many people know, a major route of traffic for a lot of people coming to in and out of Northampton. We submitted the petition and gathered about 38, 39 signatures on short notice because we're really concerned about the safety of the street. We have folks pretty typically traveling in excess sometimes of 60 miles per hour, changing lanes, there are a number of kids, many, many children who live on the street. There are 2 daycare centers. There is an elderly services program. There's a program called the Starlight Program that's on the other end of Nonotuck, and of course the high school and Cooley Dickinson. At this point in time, we really appreciated that the city has stepped in on occasion and installed the electric monitor of speed, and police officers on occasion on the corner I know of New Street and Nonotuck are often put there to hopefully mitigate some of the speeding. Unfortunately, I've spent lots and lots of hours sitting outside of my house on the steps just watching traffic flow and traffic volume. Not only do we have a lot of volume, but unfortunately those signs and even police presence only deals with the speeding and the reckless driving for a short period of time. So we're concerned about the street. We feel, this is my daughter, Romery.
You go to recognize.
If she could speak, she
would.
She
needs no
I'm a little bit jumbled here, but what I'd like to say is that I really appreciate all the information that you all in the committee presented in the traffic calming manual. It was really helpful for me and my wife and family and our neighbors to get our heads around what the process is. It's clear that at this point in time, Nonotuck and mitigating traffic on Nonotuck and becoming a traffic calm neighborhood would be a high priority for the city. As I said, it provides access to the high school, daycare centers, senior centers, Starlight Center, Cooley Dick, and it's a major walking route to and from school for high school students. It's heavily traveled by pedestrians, both on bicycle and on foot, and unfortunately we don't have any crosswalks whatsoever on Nonotuck, so there are some dangerous crossings there as well. In terms of the prioritization criteria that are indicated on the manual itself, I think a traffic easement study would show that we have a huge volume of traffic. We have tremendous speeding that happens on the road. We have had numerous crashes in the last couple of years that I think a couple of the residents will speak to directly. We have only one sidewalk on the street. And as I said, that cross between the 2 sidewalks, there is no crosswalk whatsoever. High pedestrian activity and a huge amount of neighborhood support. Unfortunately, I was, and I really appreciated the opportunity to present today. It was a very short notice for me to get the word out to others in the community on the street about this hearing. And I think that it speaks tons to the concern of the neighborhood and the street itself that this many people have shown up. And I trust that if it weren't on 4 o'clock, at 4 o'clock on a Tuesday and we had more time, you'd probably see a lot more folks here in person. I would also expect that a number of residents, if not a slew of residents on our street, will also be writing in place of being here to submit specific comments and concerns about this safety issue. So we greatly appreciate you all taking this seriously. We really hope that the interest that we've shown, the commitment of the neighborhood, and our ranking very high on this set of criteria will at least initiate a traffic calming study so that we can get real clear numbers and data and figure out what can be done to mitigate this issue. Before I turn it over to the rest of the folks on Naugatuck, what I would say without being gloom and doom is that I know in talking to residents and all of the folks I talked to, every single person had a story, if not five stories, about backing up out of their driveway and getting sideswiped, having part of their house taken off by a tractor trailer, mention of a young woman getting hit on Naugatuck and New Street and killed many years ago now. My concern as a dad is that because of the excessive speeding, and this is not only speeding, but people changing lanes and passing each other going 45, 50, 55 miles an hour, that we're really waiting for a serious accident to take place, and that addressing this now can avoid a major catastrophe that could happen in the short term or later future. So I appreciate your time, and thank you very much.
Great, thank you. And do you want to just stay up for 1 second?
I'd
like to just briefly recap. You actually started to explain the process itself, I think, well. It sounds like you understand it perfectly. But I'll recap the traffic calming process, what we may or may not do today. And then I'd like to ask members of the commission if they have any questions for you before we then invite others to come up. Basically, what we may do today is take a vote to start the process of looking at the traffic calming in this area. And that would mean, as a first step, doing a traffic study of speed and possibly counters and this kind of thing. And if that happens, the DPW would go ahead and do that. We'd recommend that they do that. At a later date, data would come back, and we'd consider that again in light of all the data we had. And so that would be another opportunity for other residents who may not be able to be here today to comment if they want to speak at that time as well. So that's what we're doing today.
Yeah.
It's not an ultimate decision one way or another. It's whether or not we're going to go forward with the study.
Yeah.
So just to make that comment, and with that, are there any questions from Ms. Petruccia from the commission before we move on to others?
I have one question. You had a list of the area from the high school to Coon Lake, yet the STAR facility is down further towards Porticelli. Do you want it to go further than North Maple?
My sense has been, in my limited observations, that a lot of the speeding, the people tend to pick up speed after North Maple.
Okay.
And then once they get up over the rise and once they get down the hill towards Elm Street and start making a beeline towards the high school, I leave it up to others to determine whether the area between North Maple and the Silk Mill building is also an area of concern.
Okay.
There are less houses and residents there and more businesses, obviously, with Chemi Plastic and others. So I was less concerned personally about that area, although I defer to other people to use their best judgment in that matter. If increasing the size of the study puts us lower down the list, then I would encourage the study to be done from North Maple to the bottom in the high school. But if it's the contiguous Naugatuck Street Elm corridor that the study would be done for, then I think that would be a smart and wise idea.
I want to respond to that, actually. I've gotten two calls over the last year and a half about people turning from Pine Street onto Naugatuck by the factory there and being sideswiped when they're trying to get out of the cars. So I think there is concern from the people that are kind of whipping around the corner off of Pine Street. So it seems to me that it might be useful to also measure speeds as people are coming from that direction.
Thank you, I appreciate that.
Any other questions or comments? Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
What about you? You want to say something? It looks as it all looks. Are there any other residents who'd like to come? You're welcome to come up. And again, if you'd state your name and address for it.
I'm Katie Olmsted, and I live at 59. I've been there for 12 years. So I am the west side of Hinkley, just past Hinkley. I'm home a lot, I'm not employed, and I have very good hearing. And I hear the speed of small trucks, big trucks, motorcycles, cars, and I can judge pretty well. So the cars are coming from the high school. The high school to North Main is 35 miles an hour, and then it decreases at the crest of the hill just by me to 30. That's the point where I can hear people are picking up speed. It's a cut through. It's avoiding Main Street. So I can hear that people are speeding up, and I hear regularly cars that I'm judging at certainly 45 miles an hour is really common, not 30. And it is kids on both sides. While sitting at my counter last summer, I heard a car coming really fast from the high school end. He hit his brakes at the bottom of my driveway and skidded. I forget what the police measured it at, almost to New Street, no, to the street that goes up the hill.
Baker Hill.
He came over the hill, he saw that there was a car turning left to go up Baker Hill who was waiting because there was somebody coming the other way. He was going, we figure, 65 miles an hour. He hit his brakes at my driveway and skidded until he hit the car at Baker Hill. The police came, there was a small child in the car, nobody was hurt. The skid marks went that full distance from my driveway. And I heard that slam, that sound of the brakes crash, which I can still hear in kind of a PTSD way. That's what I hear on the street. I met Alexander when I was walking one day, and he has these great signs that say, drive as if your kids lived here. And we stopped and we talked about our street. And he has this great habit that I don't quite have the chutzpah to do, that he waves at people as they're going by in this really friendly way, like, hi, you're driving through my neighborhood, don't I know you? People slow down and they look at him like you're crazy, but they slow down because they see that there's a human being here. This is not a highway piece. This is not just we'll drive as fast as we can. I mean, I was talking to a friend the other day who lives up in the hill towns who said, oh yeah, I cut through your rain and your street all the time, and I don't know what speed she's going at, but it is a cut through. And it's not a country, it's our neighborhood. And it is dangerous. The speeds are excessive. I had a letter to the editor myself some months ago, which was followed by a letter to the editor from one of the docs at the Nonotuck Olson. I don't know that it's getting worse, but it's certainly not getting any better. And I know that part of the deal is that we don't make recommendations for traffic calming measures, but I sure would love to see the speed humps that are coming in, like on North Street and Jackson Street, that they don't make people have to stop and go over, but they really make people slow down. And, if somebody's going 60 miles an hour, they're going to react to there being a speed hump. I was driving down the street the other day, and there were two cars in front of me, and they were playing. They were young guys, and they were chasing each other. They were going in and out of cars. If there was something in the road that slowed them down from their little game of going at high speed, and there is a double yellow line, and passing in and out, it was just lucky that everybody was very mindful that there were idiots on the road. So.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Are there any questions for Ms. Olmsted? Thank you for that information. Anyone else? Who's next?
Hi. My name is Louise Martindale, and I am a resident of 198 Naugatuck Street, which is Blue House at the bottom of Maple Street on Naugatuck. Pretty prominently placed among all these intersecting streets. My husband Michael and I have been living there over 2 years since November, and we're really excited to raise it our family in the neighborhood. We love Florence, we love the area, we take daily walks. And we love that it's a street with multi-generational families, bikers, pedestrians. But the speeding is really a concern. When we moved into the house, we knew it was a heavy traffic street, but we were not prepared for the incessant speeding and the regular speeding. I've been home on maternity leave this past 3 months, so I'm now also witnessing it during the daytime. It's regular in the evenings and on the weekends, but I'm now very aware that it's really 24 hours a day. I also wanted to mention that when I'm driving on Naugatuck, I'm often tailgated. So I abide by the speed limit. I go 35 from up on Elm, then cross Federal, where it turns into 30. And often, where it decreases to 30, drivers behind me will literally drive 3 to 5 feet behind my car and honk. And it's very scary, especially when you have a baby in the car, but I refuse to increase my speed. Speeding is an issue all the way to the intersection of Maple and Naugatuck, and I would say continuing on to Pine Street, especially where Maple crosses Naugatuck. We have that intersection where Maple turns into Riverside Drive. There's no stop sign and no yield sign there, so cars come whipping around right in front of our driveway and our neighbor's driveway, and there's been several near misses when I've been backing out the driveway. So we've kind of learned, we have guests over, to have people stop and, you know, have someone direct them out of our driveway because there's no stop sign there and people don't look. I also wanted to bring up that on June 7th of this year, there was an accident due to speeding on Naugatuck Street that resulted in our fence being damaged. We fenced in our yard, and it was the evening of June 7th. We luckily weren't home because we do spend a lot of time in our yard. I often park the baby in the baby carriage in the yard. I no longer do that in the front yard because of this accident. But a car was coming from the high school direction, heading towards Pine Street, and actually crossed over the lane and into our house, into our fence, knocking out fence sections and landing in our yard. So they didn't just get up on the curb, they actually entered our yard, and that was very frightening. And we're just lucky no one was hurt. I did want to bring your attention also to the intersection of Maple and Naugatuck Street. It's not very intuitive for drivers as to how to navigate that intersection. Maple Street comes down as one road and splits into two. They're both one way, and we constantly, when we're in our backyard, see drivers go up one way and down the other way. Some people think it's one way, some people think it's dual way. It's very dangerous. We've witnessed accidents. Drivers are confused, and so it's a speeding issue, but there's also this confusion among how to navigate that area of the city. So I just want to thank you all for considering and listening to everyone tonight. I had been in touch with Ryan about undertaking and Elisa about the process of a traffic calming study, and that's how I learned that Alex was actually doing one. So I was just in the past few weeks going to try to gather signatures, so I was so happy to learn that there was another neighbor on our street already starting this process. And I'm sure there's others out there that aren't here tonight, so I just really want to thank you all for your consideration.
Thank you. Any questions for Ms. Martin?
Thank you.
Thank you. Natasha, I've seen you.
Hello.
Been waiting patiently.
My name is Natasha Yakovlev, and I live at 147 Nonotuck Street. We've been there for a little over 12 years now, and I just want to say I second everything you've already heard up until now, but I do think that the traffic has gotten much worse. The speeding is insane on our street, and what I'm noticing that the hours of the day that I'm driving are usually really early in the morning and then later in the afternoon, and if I have to take a left-hand turn into my driveway, I'm taking my life into my hands. I was really excited yesterday because somebody actually stopped the full car length behind me, and I thought, oh wow, I can relax and turn into my driveway as opposed to bracing myself because there's a car coming, not slowing down, and trying to just move over and make room to go around me on the shoulder of the road. There isn't a shoulder on the road. And it's particularly concerning because on that side of the street, there's no sidewalk for children, and there's kids playing in yards and animals and everything else. But so I do think it's getting worse, and I'm noticing a lot of young operators behind the wheel of the car, and I have a daughter who just got her head this week, so I'm more cognizant of behind the wheel, and it concerns me the traffic going to the high school, particularly in the mornings when kids are running late, and then again in the afternoons when they're just rushing to get out of there. It's a real problem. That's it. And also, in terms of the study, if it were to go to Maple or further up to Pine Street, coming down Corticelli to take a left to Nonotuck is also sometimes taking your life into your hands because there's a real blind spot there for the traffic coming from Pine Street and if you're trying to get off of Corticelli. So it would be wonderful to see a study happen at that end also. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Are there any questions? Ms. Roberts?
Just a general question for anybody who's a resident. Trucks, small trucks, pickup trucks, delivery trucks, UPS, tractor trailers,
semi-trailers,
as well as passenger vehicles.
Yes, and we have there's a motorcycle. I'm sure everyone else here has heard it.
Oh, at 4 in the morning?
All hours of the day. My husband was home yesterday because I said to him, I haven't heard the motorcycle in a while. He said, I heard it at 3 o'clock yesterday afternoon. The guy travels easily 65, 70 miles per hour on a motorcycle down the straight stretch of Northampton. It's really just an accident right now.
Thanks.
Thank you.
I'm going to cut in line real quick. Can I cut in line
to
leave with the baby? I'm sure you all appreciate that.
You've got the babies, please.
My name is Hannah Gobay. I'm Alexander Kapuchis' wife. I just wanted to say that the radar speed readout sign that gets parked is within, we can see it at our front door. So one thing that as Katie said, kind of get used to the sound of the traffic and what's an appropriate sound for a car that's going the speed limit and what's the sound of a car that's speeding. And one thing I like to do is sit outside and kind of guess how fast people are going. And then the way that the tree limbs hang out and the way that the road just turns a little bit, people can't quite see it before the speed starts reading out and they see it, they slow down. So people are almost always going at least 40 miles an hour, 45 miles an hour. And you can tell the difference when someone is actually going 30, 32, 33 miles an hour. It sounds quiet. It sounds like what a car should sound like going through a residential neighborhood. And that's not the sounds that I hear when I'm in my home or when I'm, you know, rarely hanging out in the front yard because it's completely noise pollution makes it really unpleasant.
I would also just say because my husband is so social, he does go out on the street. And one thing I've noticed is that
I certainly find that I speed through neighborhoods sometimes without realizing it. And I don't think there is adequate speed signage on Nonotuck Street. There's one speed sign going toward Pine Street from the high school that says it's 30, and then there's nothing. And so it's a straightaway, and you might just not be paying attention and realize your speed's crept up, you're on a straightaway. And so I can understand that. Maybe if there were more signs, people would realize. What's been a little disheartening is that my husband goes out there and goes, please slow down. And people have flipped him off. People to my father-in-law, who has New Jersey plates, granted, have beeped at him, passed him when he's going, like we always make a point now to go to the speed limit.
people ride our tails, people pass us, honk at us, like I said, people speed up and are rude. So that's a little disheartening. But I know it's not just that some people aren't aware, because I know that is part of it. But it's a hope that we can address as much as we can, all of it. I'm going to take her home.
No, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Don't worry, my pass. Anyone else? Oh, ma'am, you had your hand up, and then you, sir.
Okay.
Oh,
let's go.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Thanks. Sure.
I'm Lauren Salmon. I live at 197 Nonotuck, and I can project about the baby. I've been there since 1987 on the corner of Nonotuck and Maple, directly across from Louise and my family baby. The street's a real thoroughfare. It's a bypass from all of the sets of lights in Florence. So people come in from, you know, the outer edges of Florence Road, Birds Pit Road, and it's a really easy way to bypass every single set of traffic lights in downtown. So we are a thoroughfare. When the city widened the street and did such a beautiful job many years ago, it did create this potential for a really nice, easy, smooth street to cruise down. And I witness it daily, hourly when I'm home. Speeds are excessive. There's also these, you know, tricky intersections that are not so clearly marked and not so intuitive. They're very unintuitive in a couple places. There's a stop sign, which I think is just missing from Louise's, which has been gone forever from the end, the small end of Maple out. When I moved there in 87, it was soon after a child was killed on the street. And our city councilwoman at the time convened a forum for people in the neighborhood. And it was just an opportunity to convey our concerns. Nothing came of it. And it's nice that there's a system in place for us to have some sort of process for possibly addressing it. I love the idea of narrowing or perceived narrowing of the street. The street would really be used as sidewalks on both sides, if there were sidewalks on both sides. It would be even more beautiful if the sidewalk came back into the road and swallowed up a little of the road width, which is an unnecessarily generous width of road along that stretch. We get a lot of trucks. We get trucks. I'm glad you asked about that. We get trucks, particularly industrial trucks, like from Willard's, because that's their route. And they're loud, and they're just heavy, good trucks. We get, because we borderline on industrial from Maple down to Pine, it's mixed-use industrial. So there are factories that use their full-size trucks, and they're not going up and down Maple Street if they can avoid it. They're going down Nonotuck the whole stretch. We do see cars speed up when they come from, and this was a question Alex asked because he couldn't speak to it, but coming from Pine, that's where they start picking up speed because it becomes straight and easy. And by the time they get to our treacherous intersection of Maple, they're not ready for it. When somebody's not certain how they're going to exit or enter that intersection, it's really dicey. And I think the reason why we haven't had more potential injuries of kids is because the neighborhood aged over the last 20 years. And we have new families now, and I love that, and I want them safe. You know, I want to cut down the noise, but we haven't had a lot of kids on the street for almost 20 years. So it's a big change, and it's a very critical time to look at that. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions, Ms. Kennedy? Thank you very much.
All right. My name is John Van Beckham. I live on Nonotuck Street between New Street and Maple Street. So I'm at 153. And just down a few houses from you guys. And I'm representing one of the two daycares that are on Nonotuck Street. So we feel a lot of the pressure of traffic as parents come in the morning to drop off their little ones. And that's just as many of the folks have already spoken about. But that's a dicey operation when you have people who are used to using it as a straightaway, having to slow down behind a family that's trying to bring their toddler in to our house. And then one house down the way is another daycare. So these are two daycare centers quite close to each other. So the coming and going of bringing children in and having that be a relaxing situation, or at least not a dangerous situation, is a huge issue. We we don't bring, my wife will not bring the children out past our side door on our garage, on our driveway, because of the threat. We wouldn't normally bring a young child out onto a busy road, but cars are speeding that way. It's just a no-brainer. It's just kind of terrified to even think about what could happen. There's no time to slow down when you're going 45 or 50 and something comes out, a bicycle, a car backing out, it might be spacing out a little bit, not paying attention. There's no time to react. And the lack of reaction time makes a lot of folks on this stretch of road. We're the ones that have to do the planning. We're the ones that have to do the safety. It's probably true everywhere in the world. There are three things that slow traffic down on Nonotuck. Number one, my car. I park it on Nonotuck Street, and cars have to drive around it, and the traffic slows down. They're not happy about it. They'll speed anyway. But when my car's there, I feel like it's a little buffer. And I didn't do that intentionally until I realized it actually worked. Going out to get in my car is a little dangerous, but it's worth it because it slows the traffic down a little bit. There's a dip on the way, you all know it, on the way to Northampton High School. There's a big dip in the road. And everybody who drives there knows it, so you don't want to ruin your front end, so you slow down. And the third thing is any other cars that are parked on the road that tend to narrow the street. So then you have to go through a narrower section, and then cars have to negotiate that somehow. It's a long stretch of unregulated road. From the high school to Pine Street, there's no stop sign. There's a 30-mile-an-hour sign that appears at the top, heading westbound on Nonotuck. It's 30 miles an hour, and then there's no sign at all until you get... Actually, there's no sign at all on the eastbound side of the road, westbound side, all the way to Pine Street. So there's not enough information that, in fact, this is 30. A slower place, and it goes from 35 to 30 where there's this long kind of straightaway drag situation. There's a couple motorcycles that use it as a drag race situation, and they will go 65, 70 miles an hour, hell bent, and I'm just thinking, when's the day going to come when that's going to end in a tragedy? And other cars that are driving recklessly. So on behalf of the daycares that are there and the little children and the folks that like to take a walk in the evening, we appreciate you hearing these observations, and thank you for putting up the speed sign on the road. Did I mention that's one thing that slows people down? The digital speed sign where people are recognizing, oh yeah, in fact, I am going 47. And sometimes I speed on there, so it helps check me too.
Okay.
So that's great.
Well, and thank you for your comments. Be careful getting in your car.
I know, I do like that, John.
Anyone else?
My name's Amanda Hack. I live at 14 Nonotuck Street. I live right sort of where Nonotuck and South Main kind of split. So one thing that I have really awesome neighbors who live right across the street, and I love to visit them, but it's really scary to cross that street. And I'm an adult, and I can like watch and see how fast traffic is going. And even for me, trying to walk across that, it's just like, oh, do I go yet? They're going really fast. Or do I just wait for it to be empty? And again, with the motorcycles, I've been woken up in the morning, like 4, 5 in the morning, to hear those god-awful noise machines just barreling down the road. And it does feel kind of unsafe in that area. I also once got into an accident because I was backing out of my driveway and somebody was driving up the road, and I looked to see that I was clear, and I was, but because they were going so fast, I heard them, you know, starting to break, and this is going up the hill, and you could see the skid marks on the road from where they started to break till where they hit me. It is kind of terrifying, and I don't know if you had this instance in the winter, like with those high snow banks. Again, with people going really fast, even in the winter time, it's like doubly terrifying. And then also, I think it's Federal Street that goes in that near that intersection where I am. It's really hard to see traffic. You can see traffic kind of coming up the hill, but you can't see traffic going down into town and toward the high school. So you kind of have to basically stick the front nose of your car out into the other lane in order to see around there. So I don't know if there was a mirror or something put on a telephone pole for people to help see around that area, but that's like another intersection that's potentially hazardous for people. But yeah, definitely it's super loud. I mean, I know my neighbors who live across the street, they hear the cars a lot, and I really think it would be helpful to figure out how to reduce the speed for the safety of the residents and the safety of the drivers on the road too. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comment?
Hi. I'm Christine Holly Baker, 11 North Street in Sequoia. And so we don't live on Naugatuck, but we live on the first house around the corner on New Street. And I'm a teacher, and during the summer when I'm home, I'm driving around a lot during the day. And I'm driving with a child, do drive the speed limit much more than I ever did when I was a younger person. And I notice so often that it's become unremarkable, I don't even say it to my husband anymore, that when I'm turning right, having come from downtown, when I'm turning right onto my street, it's very often that, as people have described, I'm being tailgated very aggressively. And as soon as I turn onto my street, there's this sound behind me like a blast off that reminds me of like that really road rage, aggressive driving that I'm used to maybe seeing like on the highway, in a divided highway. But it's happening in this residential neighborhood about to be going through an area with a lot of children and, as people have said, in daycare centers. And so if the noise isn't as much of an issue for us, but certainly the safety is a concern with being near the street.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions for Quora or Ms. Baker?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Any other comments?
I'd like to say something.
Please,
I don't live on Naugatuck Street, but with my job, I drive around the city all day.
You don't think they stole your signs, do you?
No. Because I feel for them, because the intersection at Maple and Naugatuck, I've been doing my job for 30 years, people are totally confused. I don't know, if you're coming down Maple Street to Naugatuck, it's split. I mean, there's an island in the middle. Some people go to the left, take a left of the island. When you're coming up Naugatuck, some people take a left up the left side of that island, and very often you confront somebody coming up where you're going down, and it's, I know we eliminated that up in Leeds on Florence Street. Remember, we used to have that issue, and then even after we fixed it, there was, I'd be sitting at the light and like, oh my gosh, somebody's gonna hit me here, because they're still not paying attention, but it got better. So I think that needs to be fixed there. And the other one down at South Main, across from Federal, I drive there all the time, trying to get out to take a left or go straight across on Federal. It's blind. And even, and I'm agreeing with the person coming off of Corticelli Street onto Naugatuck, right behind the mini mall.
Yep.
You can't see. You're taking your life in your hands. Every time you come out to take a left there, it's crazy. And I use that street a lot because it is a cut through, but I go to speed limit and they're so right. People are right on your behind constantly. It's just crazy.
Okay. Any questions from Ms. White? Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Any other comment? Seeing none, I think we're going to kind of launch into our deliberation and discussion of this ourselves, and out of an abundance of caution, we have a commission member who lives in the neighborhood who's going to take a walk and look at the birds. And so I would like to hear from the commission on this. Any thoughts? Or I have some thoughts, but I know you do.
I'd strongly suggest that we get the traffic cameras out there at various locations and collect some data.
Okay.
See what you find.
And do you know, so do you want to make a formal motion?
Sure. And we go up there, place between three or four counters throughout the length of the street, and collect speed, volume, and classification of vehicles.
And I know there's some question about the exact area of focus. So when you say the street, I mean, from where to just
My understanding would be from Pine down to probably somewhere around Riverside anyways, if not perhaps up to high school.
Okay. So from Pine Street to high school, is that true?
Second that motion.
Okay. Any discussion on the motion to start the process and do a traffic study? I just have a quick question. Cooley Dickinson has kind of a back entrance there. And my understanding is that, you know, I mean, first of all, there's many forms that speed that traffic calming can take, but in terms of speed bumps, do ambulances travel on these roads?
The Cooley Dickinson road itself has mega speed bumps on it.
Oh yeah.
Much higher than the speed humps that the town uses. So they've already got like four of them. If somebody's going in the back door with an ambulance, back road, they have to go over serious, serious bumps, about four, to get to the hospital. So,
but ambulances do use the road.
Although they may not use that entrance by ambulances.
Not very often.
I think they intentionally don't. That's not something we see a lot of use of.
Thank you.
So Hospital Road used to be a public way until about 12 years ago. We discontinued to give it to the hospital. They took over ownership of it, and they actually put those speed humps in to slow the volume of traffic on each facility.
Okay. All right, any other discussion on the specific motion? This is traffic, this is collecting traffic data from the high school to Pine Street, essentially.
Can I ask
one? Sure. Go ahead.
I would request that when you're collecting the data, that the electronic sign be removed, because that slows people down. And we want it to be more realistic.
We'll coordinate that with the police department.
Thank you. Okay. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Okay. Thank you very much, and thank you to all the residents, and we'll be in touch. When the data comes back, it's time to bring this up again.
So just as a point of process, I'm sorry.
No, I was just turning because you were talking.
Go ahead. To the gentleman over there, I didn't know if I was about to cut you off.
No, please, go ahead.
Just, I wanted to, in terms of process, so once the data is collected, you'll be in touch with me, and then at that point in time, there'll be another opportunity for us to come and to hear the results of the data?
Exactly.
Great.
Thank you
so very much
for your time.
Thank you.
Mr. Conrad,
thank you.
That's like what we had in mind yesterday.
We can look at that. Usually what we do is speed zones and then the signs are solved to begin other where it changes.
Excuse me, just a second. Folks, could I ask you to continue your conversation?
Yes, excuse us. Pardon me.
Can you stay on?
I know.
What else?
So basically, the way we do speed zoning in the city is that when they have a change in the speed, we can install a new sign going from 325 or 345, whatever it is, and it runs for a segment of roadway. If you get on Route 66, there's probably a mile and a half, 2 miles of roadway. There's one sign at the West Farms, where it changed, just past West Farms, and it doesn't change again until almost 4 inches over. It doesn't say you can't put more signs down, but that's typically how it's done.
I think it's still a good point to consider as far as.
I thought that someone also brought up a concern about missing stop sign. Is there supposed to be a stop sign somewhere, one of those intersections, Maple, that's missing? Is that one of the branches?
That's really good. There used to be two stop signs, one on each side of the island there. And that's being reconfigured through the existing paving contract to be just a T intersection. So that dual driveway access coming into Maple Street will disappear, hopefully this year.
Okay.
Anything else before we move on? Just another item? Well, let's see. I see our esteemed former colleague who just stepped off the commission here. I wonder if we could skip to item number 10, which is just reviewing traffic calming applications in this process generally. And so in doing, that might be a good opportunity. Devin, I don't know if you want to say anything. I mean, you expressed interest in
No, I was actually curious on, I'm not sure that I don't have the agenda, but I came because I was interested in the discussion on pedestrian crosswalks.
Okay.
You may not get to it after the time taken for that one, but...
Well, you know, we got to that agenda item and then we just moved on because there was no one from the subcommittee, but
okay.
It might actually be better if we want to return that item, if that's okay, at the commission, and then you might want to... Are you just interested or do you have...
No, I'm just interested. I have no comments.
Oh, okay. Well, in that case, there's no one to provide anything interesting for you. But okay. But I also wanted to recognize Devin and say thank you for being a member of the commission and your duties
DeWitt,
on the planning board have become...
Yeah, and DeWitt will be sitting on the bicycle subcommittee with Wayne, and Wayne will be coming to this one for planning board. So we just all sort of reassigned ourselves to different seats. Not that we get to do that. I'm sorry. The mayor did that for us.
Approval of the council.
Yeah.
All right. Well, in that case, if it's okay, we'll just go in regular order here and go to item number six. Item number six is temporary relocation of a bus stop, of the bus stop at Pulaski Park. So, Director Huntley, do you want to kick us off?
Sure. In your packet tonight, there's a little map drawn by Northampton Public Works about some changes we'll be making on Main Street across from Masonic Street. For the construction of Pulaski Park. Due to that construction, there's two locations that we're looking at for potential bus stops. One would be on the Academy of Music's lawn, or the other one being on Memorial Hall lawn. The problem with the Academy of Music is all the queuing of the buses. There's typically 2 to 3 buses queued up at any given time in front of Pulaski Park. So I personally think the best place for it would be down in front of Memorial Hall. It's a temporary thing while construction's going on this fall. Hopefully enough would be done to be relocated before this year's over back. But with it, we're going to lose a number of parking spaces on Main Street for that period of time also. Just so everyone's aware of that. You're going to be down probably almost all the spaces except for the driveway coming to Memorial Hall, and one of them is the handicap space. So maybe we look at leaving that one particular space there and make the rest for buses. But I said short term, the project's probably going to go into next spring, but we think the bulk of the work, especially on the street level, will be done this calendar year.
Questions or comments on that?
Just for the commission members, because I'm working Memorial Hall, just to note that the driveway that goes between the church and Memorial Hall. There's a lot of traffic in and out of there between the church and human resources and the veterans offices on a daily basis. And with that handicapped spot there, you really have to stick your nose out into the center of the street to sort of pull out, especially if you want to go left or head west. That coupled with the fact that there is a lot of people who just hang out at the bus stop, not necessarily going to get on a bus. It's just a big hangout spot. So if we're going to relocate the bus stop there, I would recommend going as far west as we can, stay away from the driveway area. But obviously you have a big tree, you've got the plaza area where the Veterans Memorial is. So it's a tight area, but I would recommend pushing as far to the west as we can, just for safety.
Any other comments? So are there other alternatives you looked at? Or it doesn't seem like there really is. There would be many.
No, Joe, you said the bus stop in front of Thorns. Even then, I don't think the bus stop's there anymore. It hasn't for years.
In front of Thorns?
In front of Thorns?
It's still stopped.
Is it still stopped there?
There's still a bus stop sign up.
Do they stop?
Maybe not for
you. I know that there is a van stops there. The shorter one stops there.
Okay.
Because I've seen that one. I can't say that for the larger one, but the shorter, maybe 16 person, 20 person, whatever that one is, that stops there.
Well, the only place I can think of doing is to do it after Central Services and Memorial Hall driveway and take up the spaces in front of City Hall. We've got the four spaces there on each side of the access to the parking lot, two on each side, two in front of City Hall, two on the other side of the drive coming in. That can stage two buses, but not three. But the shelter, I don't know where we put the shelter as a temporary shelter.
And it's right, it'll be right on top of the crosswalk. How many parking spaces? Oh, please, Ms. Forstall.
Once again, I think that we're looking at a safety issue with the driveway, because that's the driveway that leads back to the building that I'm in, this building. And the traffic flow in and out of here, especially during tax time, is it's pretty busy. Also, with people pulling out, or people when they come down Main Street and they make that quick right onto Crass Avenue, and there's a crosswalk right there, that's a dangerous turn to begin with, let alone have a large two buses there.
I don't know if it's possible to hold the buses at bay up at John and Green Hall or not, and let them down one at a time. That's what the PPTA can do. That way, we moved it to in front of the Academy of Music. There'd only be one bus there at a given time. They all communications between all the buses. So I don't know if that's a possibility or not. But we definitely need a relocation for a period of time, very soon.
Then I'm assuming you've checked the location of fire hydrants in these areas too, right?
I didn't see any on here, but hydrants typically, if they're not building connections, for the pumpers to hook up to, the hydrants are typically probably 500 feet apart. There might be some distances downtown between hydrants.
I just thought of it when you mentioned in front of City Hall, because I'm pretty sure there's one in front of City Hall, which would make it prohibitive for a space, I imagine, for the buses.
I don't recall that.
Can this be done in a way to preserve the handicap parking spot? Is that the one that's right at the driveway that we're...
Right at the driveway. If you're looking at this plan, it says proposed 6-foot-wide temporary sidewalk relocation for construction. So what they're doing, they're pushing this out into the street. There's a temporary ADA accessible sidewalk while the new vertical curb and the sidewalk's being set along in front of the park. So you're going to lose those 1, 2, 3, 4 spaces right off the bat, which really leaves 5, 6, 7, and 8 is the handicap space, if I recall correctly. Either that, do we look at, you know, there's one shelter there, or is there two shelters in the park?
One.
One?
Yeah.
Okay.
Are you looking for just a formal motion and a recommendation?
It was just a recommendation. What Jim wanted it, Jim Lord, the city engineer, wanted it, so that we can direct the contractor as to our preferred thought.
How much value is there in inquiring whether the buses can queue differently before they get to the Academy of Music? I mean, it sounds like we don't have much time.
We can ask the question of PBTA and see what they can do.
And would that be actually a superior plan if they queued up by, you know, up the road and then had only one?
Yeah, I just don't know if their route schedules are and how they...
Well, if someone wants to make a motion to make a recommendation, otherwise, I mean, you know, we don't have to make a recommendation if we don't actually know what we're recommending, to be perfectly honest. So I leave it up to the expertise in the room to see if you want to make a motion or not.
Do you think this should be for 3 months then? Is that what you're saying?
Well, the contract supposedly is going to get signed this week, which means the contract will probably start sometime in early September at best. And they're making the big push to get as much as they can done this year. I can only imagine that one of the focuses will be this front area here so that everything is restored well before season ends, which is typically in mid-November.
does the DPW itself have a recommendation?
No.
Okay. Well, we can always have no recommendation here, too.
We'll figure things out.
But unless, you know.
But I got my notes here. We can give PVTA a call about queuing the buses at other locations like John and Green Hall. And Dave Palmer suggested we push that back as far west as possible, too.
Right.
And with two or three spaces left there, there's not going to be much room.
Why don't you go and plan a meeting with Jim out front of the building and see if we can stake something out possibly?
Okay.
So you'll proceed kind of administratively, and lack of recommendation from this commission doesn't preclude you from that. Buses will still flow down Main Street. Okay, anything else on this item? All right. So now we are on item number 9, which is that old ordinance from the mayor for the purpose of prohibiting parking in municipal parking lots during a snow emergency during certain hours. Again, unless anyone has anything new on this, unless there's any objection, I'd like to move this to a future meeting because I have nothing new on this from the mayor this time, unless anyone else does. Okay, without objection, we'll continue this to our next meeting. Item number 10 is reviewing traffic calming applications generally. I might ask Councilor Klein to help me with this item, but basically I know we have a number of them that are already queued, and we were interested in discussing at some point, maybe not now, but in the future, how do we keep track of those and revisit them at appropriate times? Councilor, is that a fair representation?
Yeah, I guess what I was interested in is just seeing some kind of, whether it be written or not, at least some clear protocol for how we're proceeding. Because I know that a number of people have contacted me and said, so we have the traffic calming study done, what's the next step, or what's the step after that, or how do you make decisions about how money is then spent to put things into place. So I think we need a decision-making process around that, whether it be even to let the DPW make those decisions and make the recommendations, or it's something that we do together. But I just think we need a little bit more clarity about what the protocol is around how these traffic studies, traffic calming processes proceed. So we can be clear to people, and so we can move them along, because we now have 23 or 24 in the queue.
25, and tonight would be 26.
26 in the queue, and we need to, I think, have some clarity around the movement.
And so there's a handout tonight that we produced, basically pre-booked a traffic calming request number 24, which is Chestnut Street. We haven't done anything in the North Main as far as a ranking was, but this is the ranking criteria. And also tells you what the outcome was, what the project happened with. Is the project completed? When was it completed? And so on. And as you can see, the ones that are in the gray shade are projects that have been completed at this point. And some projects just aren't probably going to go too far, like TC9, Austin Circle. Basically, that's a school drop-off zone on the backside of the Ryan Road School. And it didn't make it that far into it. We did a little study out there, but you can see the ranking is pretty low on it. We also do have money now from the capital improvements plan for traffic calming applications that we never did before. So that was funded, I believe, last year or the year before that. We have $100,000 set aside. And we spent, I think, about $4,000 striping South Main Street was one of those requests. That was, I don't know which application that was, South Main Street. TC number 13. Looks like I need to update that one.
So just to be clear, it's not, I mean, this is great to have. Thank you very much for preparing it. It's not so much a question about, you know, where we stand, I guess, as much as what happens next in each of these. So that even if it's something like the new traffic engineer informs the neighborhood or informs us, and we have to decide who who is the conduit to the applicants, how they're informed, how decisions are, if it's identified that some kind of mechanisms need to be put in place, how the decisions are made about what those mechanisms are going to be, what the funding year is going to be, how we inform people about that. So just really, really basic kind of steps about how each of these is going to unfold.
Ms. Grant.
Would you be so kind as to just pick a simple one to go through on how you read this? Because I'm looking at it and, sorry, it's just not super clear. You know, volume, speeding, crashes, there's, so you're saying that, like, TC1, anyone, pick one you want.
You can take a look at TC1. So every one of these have got a criteria that's met with the associated point ranking points. So if you look in the first column under criteria, you'll see volume with a 10 beside it. That's the maximum points you can get, 0 to 10. Speeding is 0 to 10. Crashes, 0 to 10. Plan DPW work, well, that's something that's going to happen if it goes up to 100. So these were evaluation criteria that was approved by the TPC a number of years ago. So that's how those numbers came out. And then basically the rest are just the information that was gathered. You know, the traffic, you know, the speed volume has got a certain range to be a 2, a 3, a 4, or a 5. So that's how that's done. There is a list out there that sets a criteria and how we determine the point value to it. And I can send that along to everybody if they want it. That way you can have a better understanding of it.
So the volume 10 is the highest on TC1, or in the column 10 is the highest, and on TC1 it happens to be ranked as a 3.
Mm-hmm.
And the 30.
You can see the asterisk underneath the 3 where it says 3,401.
Uh-huh.
That was the ADT, which is the traffic count. Both directions for that street on an average daily basis.
It's 3,400.
That's correct.
Cars.
But if you go up the South Street with a hit of 10, there's 15,000 cars a day on that street when this was done back in 2010. Bay State's old data, that's another thing we'd have to look at too. Usually you don't go past 5 years in traffic data. We'll try to update it every 5 years when you're doing information like this. So if we took, said we wanted to take a look at Bay State again, we'd have to put up the counters again to get new traffic counts out there. Because that data was collected in 2008-2009. So that data is 6-7 years old at this point.
So Nick, can you explain something about how, sorry, did I?
No, I know, I'm good. I just wanted somebody to explain what the singular digits were.
So what I'll do is I'll send out the commission the how we come up with the point value for each one, that way you see where that's coming from also.
And how internally is the decision made about what is put into place in response to, if a decision is made that in fact there's an issue, how is a decision made about what the mechanisms are going to be that go into place?
So usually there's a recommendation from the Department of Public Works to the community, the applicants, what we believe would be an effective calming device out in that particular area. Bay State Village Association ran into the issue that nobody wanted the speed bumps in front of their house. They put temporary ones out there, and people are like, I don't want this in front of mine, it makes too much noise. So that one kind of petered out on its own, because some people love the idea, they love driving over them nice and slow, but the people who live near them didn't want them near their houses. Same happened down on State Street, when we were doing on State Street, people complained about the houses out there. Vertical deflection and the bounce.
Oh. Do you have anything else?
I'm still wondering though. You said that the internally you make a decision about a recommendation.
We make a list of recommendations that we think will effectively calm traffic in that area, and then we usually have a public meeting with the applicants in the neighborhood or wherever and go over what we think would work. Most of these projects stalled because there was no money years ago when we started this program. Traffic calming started, I think, in 2007 or 2006. Everyone loved the idea, but there was no money to fund it. So a lot of these projects just lay dormant for quite a period of time.
So that's actually my primary concern. So now we have some money. And I'm just wondering, I mean, I know it's not the commission's money, but is there money that has gone unspent that could have been used for traffic calming, or have we spent it down to zero every fiscal year?
last year, I think it was last year, we painted South Main Street, which is a recommendation out of that. I think that was about $4,000 or something. It was a little more than that to do that WL center line. Other than that, no, there's probably, I mean, plus you have the transition of transportation engineers, the loss of Laura, Alex, and now Maggie on board, and we can start making these things come forward again.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I would like to see is now that we have this pot of money, what from this list can we pull off and start thinking about doing?
Which of these need to be renewed? It sounds like which studies need to be conducted again? The debt's old.
Would it be appropriate to ask the DPW to bring that information for the next meeting? You know, which projects do we need to dust off and get new data for?
Okay.
And, you know, given the amount of money that's budgeted for traffic calming, which can we move forward that perhaps was not moving forward previously due to lack of money? So, and that...
I have a question on that. So the total points at the bottom, I can see, are there some that, if they don't meet a certain threshold, they're considered not as worthwhile to move forward with? Or is anything on this list, we say, yes, there's something that should be done, and it's fill in the blank?
What we were trying to do with the total points was trying to figure out which one was the critical ones that should be done first, and that given the finances we had at that point. That's changed in the past 2 years that we didn't have. You take a look at TC number 8, Ward Avenue. We took traffic counters out there, and the 85th percentile was going under the speed limit. So that project didn't even make it anywhere. It just stopped dead in its tracks.
Okay, so the ones that didn't make it are on here, and the ones that are on here should be done. They're just prioritized. Okay.
So I think the biggest one, probably the most one that needs to be done, is probably State Street. It's at 58.
What
I'm trying to see if anyone else pop in, hit that high. Or if they don't.
TC what?
So it'll be TC
four.
Number 4. And if James Lowenthal was here, I know that he'd be pushing for this one.
So all the gray ones have been resolved in some manner, either found to be not, don't merit some kind of traffic calming
or
response, or they've been resolved in some way.
That's correct.
Okay.
In some way, shape, or form.
And the improvements, where it says speed humps, the DPW's recommendation is speed humps.
That's correct.
Great, so that would be helpful at the next meeting if you could bring a recommendation on what you think can move forward.
Okay.
We'll have another one next month. We have one on the 10th.
Right, that's the thing. They're going to keep coming and we'll be more in the queue. So amidst all the other work I know the DPW has to do, thank you very much. Anything else on this item?
Just one question, just a quick clarification. So like on line 6 for pedestrian activity, the numbers in parentheses, 1 plus 1 plus 1, do you know that?
I don't know off the top of my head, but once you see that sheet from me, you'll be able to see why we add those up that way.
Okay.
I don't know if it's the number of crosswalks in the study area. Schools, Maggie said schools and daycare and other.
Certain locations added up.
Oh.
Okay, so schools
want,
daycare
want.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, we're also.
Pace car participation. We still have pace cars.
Now, I don't know if we still have pace car stickers or not. I remember when it came out back 2005, 2006.
When people fill out the traffic calming applications, they are mystified by what that is because it's still on the application.
Anything else for today? Okay, I think we should move on. So item number 11 is commercial truck and other traffic issues related to Lincoln Avenue. The resident who lives on Lincoln is no longer here. I mean, I don't want to spend an hour on this, but I guess we've discussed this many times in the past, but it's been an issue that has, I don't want to say reemerged, but certainly people have renewed their interest in it. And, you know, I wonder if there are any thoughts from the commission about what we might look at. For example, you heard the resident bring up issues related to signage. I personally don't think signage does all that much to calm traffic in reality. I've heard recently, and I think this has been discussed in past years, the idea of having a different turnaround for trucks, maybe down Sheldon Field or something. But I bring it up because I don't want to lose sight of it. I think it's our responsibility in this commission to talk about it, since it's been brought up recently in city council and other forums. So I raise it today, knowing there's no easy solution. But
I guess one of the questions I want to ask to that is whether or not, is it the trucks an issue? Because it doesn't appear that speeding is the issue on Lincoln. And they asked for a reduction in speeding on it, and we had a conversation about whether or not we could get special legislation passed that, because this is a emergency truck route, these side streets and so on, can we actually get special legislation to drop the speed limit to 25, which has been done in other communities for around senior citizen communities and so on.
Well, I would like to actually get the commission's feedback on this. So to restate what you just said, I mean, the city of New Bedford, I think the city of Quincy, maybe one or two others, have successfully got home rule legislation passed by the legislature that allows them to reduce the speed limit around senior centers, places where seniors congregate. I think that's what it says. Whereas normally it's a state process. So they seem to be pretty successful. Your idea was to do that around truck escape routes. I guess what I'd like to hear the commission's opinion on is, I mean, is it an actual justifiable policy decision to lower the speed limit where trucks travel through residential neighborhoods? If my constituents are here, they'd probably be mad if you just said it out loud.
Wouldn't trucks, be all vehicles would be at that speed limit, not just trucks.
That's true, but the legislation itself would be it would be premised on that idea that the reason why this is special is because trucks use this.
Correct.
So
is the concern the trucks or the speed on Lincoln, or is it both?
I think it's both. Although
the less of the data counts that we have out there, in fact, the past three sets of data counts, we have the 85th percentile doing the speed limit.
People came from Lincoln Avenue and spoke, it seemed like it was just the number of trucks. And the trucks themselves, no matter how fast or slow they're going, just make a lot of noise. It was my impression, anyway.
It's noise, it's safety.
Because I'm positive that we did a speed zoning study out there, the speed limit is not going to be lowered. So I was looking at different ways of being able to do something to reduce the speed limit, if that's what we wanted to move forward.
What constitutes an emergency? Are they only supposed to use Lincoln in an emergency? And who constitutes the emergency, and what is the emergency? And how do you?
It's basically in order to, if a driver makes a wrong turn off the highway, in order to give them an opportunity to not hit the bridge downtown.
Oh, that is an emergency.
The problem is that we suspect that it's often used in the shorter and easier. All right, unless there's anything else on that, I mean, I wanted to raise it, and I'm certain we'll revisit it in future meetings. So.
But I can only imagine that home rule is probably going to take at least a year to implement.
Right, if we were to do a home rule petition, we would pass an order asking the mayor to seek it, and Representative Kokot, presumably, we'd have to bring him in, and then new bills are filed kind of at the end of the year, and then it'd be a lengthy process. And so my real question is, I mean, while the nerd in me thinks that would be cool to do, does it actually make a real difference if we lower the speed limit to 20?
I don't think it would solve the biggest issue of just having trucks on the road at all.
Right.
I think that's the main issue.
Right. That's true. I mean, it sort of conflates the two issues. It uses one in order to lower the speed limit for everybody. So that's kind of my concern. Ms. Granite and then Ms. Forsell.
Is there enough signage on this highway? Because I don't pay attention when I get off. I'm not a truck, so I'm not paying attention. Saying, don't go this way, go this way. You know, go off the highway straight onto.
Yeah, there's a big flashing sign that was put up there a while ago.
It's based on vehicle height triggers it, flashing yellow flashers. And it's actually, they're on Bridge Street, they're down on King Street, they're on Main Street, they're a number of different locations in the city.
They probably just become blind to it or not do it, or they just ignore it.
Yeah. The GPS is telling them to go this
right
way.
Oh, GPS, right.
No, the GPS is telling them to go the right way. It's just that they ignore it and go around.
Well,
because don't they, have to GPS right into Coke?
Right, so what Coca-Cola did for their delivery address, they changed their street
right.
address.
Right.
So it'd be further down, so say, oh, the best route is to go down Damon Road to the industrial park. Exactly. But people are still going down.
Did that actually happen?
Yeah.
Yes.
I didn't know that.
So there's no way to do anything with one-way streets that would prevent, it's all the trucks pulling off of Bridge Street, is that it's not because they're coming out also? I mean, if it was a one-way street only coming off of Bridge, would that prevent them from coming out of the Coca-Cola plant and coming out that way, or is that not a problem?
The only way the trucks can go out of the Coca-Cola and get down those side streets is to go around the big rotary and the industrial park. That when Coca-Cola designed that site, we were adamant that those trucks could not leave and take a radius turn and go up to North Street. When you leave, that thing's curved so sharply that they have to go towards the rotary.
Okay, so let's get in the car.
What I don't know, and I could look at the classification counts of the vehicles, is it going to the industrial park or going to Bridge Street, the heavier truck route on Lincoln? That should have been picked up with the data collectors.
I think you get trucks in both directions as a practical matter. I guess that means they're using the rotaries to turn around. Right.
There's also been a long-standing conversation on making Day Avenue one way, which hasn't gone that far, but that was another way of preventing trucks turning off of Bridge Street up Day to go to the industrial park.
That Day is one that got a no trucks sign on it.
I'm sure it does.
It does. Like, yeah, Lincoln, all the streets do, except for Lincoln.
Except for Lincoln's the only one that doesn't, which is why the trucks use it.
On one side, coming off of Bridge Street. It's the only way. Hey, you come in from the industrial park on North Street, there's a sign there.
So a lot of the Coca-Cola drivers, the trucks that we're talking about, they're frequent visitors. They're people that know the routes. It's not like... But one of my concerns has been, and I've talked to you about this a number of times, Ned, is the backup on Damon Road, and I think that a lot of them are making a very conscious choice to go down Lincoln because they don't want to get stuck in the traffic on Damon Road because of the lights, the situation with the lights ever since the rail trail, the high-speed rail went in. So that's actually tied into, I think, another issue. I think if people could get down Damon Road a little bit quicker, they might be more likely to go that way as opposed to trying an alternative route. But this is, you know, I guess it's a mass DOT issue.
It is. I talked to Bob Lang, who's a transportation engineer, yesterday it was. And I was asking, are you still looking at restriping Damon Road from River Run condos going forward? And really, because the only way it's going to work is with some pavement widening in that area too, which they didn't think they were planning to undertake this particular construction season. So it might be something in the spring that we might see a widening of Damon Road to accommodate what they're looking at is two travel lanes starting at River Run and running straight through to King Street. And that basically there's not a dedicated left-hand turn into Industrial Park, but you can stack up double vehicles going all the way to King Street. Because right now, that's a dedicated left-hand turn into the industrial park off of Damon Road.
All right. Well, anything else on this for today? We haven't solved the problem. We expect this to. We'll revisit it. Item number 12, I would like to withdraw. The reason is I think the same subject will be integrated into a future agenda item that come from the planning department and me, which I'll return. So unless there's any objection to withdrawing that.
Just a point, there is no traffic calming application for Montview on Henry Street. There's one for the Montview neighborhood. That was one of the earlier ones where we actually put the speed bumps down on Williams and Holly.
Okay.
So technically Montview Henry does not have a traffic application for a calming application. That was a TC number 5. That work was done.
And that was.
It was just called the Montview area, is what it was called.
Okay. Great.
Just so you're aware of that.
All right.
As long as we're talking about this again, can I ask a quick question? Some of the money that was used for some of these traffic calming measures were from developers and all kinds of things. So this isn't money that came from the capital plan, it was designated.
Some of it was privately donated, like Union Street, that was completely donated by a couple neighbors that lived on the street. This was traffic mitigation, the Montview area was for traffic mitigation funds for a project. Same with South Street, a lot of that was funded through traffic mitigation from the state hospital.
And what's happening in Leonard Street Leeds, for instance, that's developer money.
That's correct.
And that's why I like to bring this up again, because there is traffic mitigation money left over for the Henry Street Montville neighborhood.
Right, there's like $15,000.
Something like that, yeah, that in the future meeting, I'd like us to discuss and make a recommendation on it. All right, is there any new business for today? Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much.